वेलकम बैक। टुडे वी विल ट्राई टू वाइंड अप दिस मॉड्यूल फॉर गुड। सो लेट्स डिस्कस द लास्ट केस दैट कम्स अंडर दिस रेशियो एनालिसिस। आई होप वी ऑलमोस्ट कवर्ड ऑलमोस्ट ऑल द टाइप्स ऑफ केसेस और एडजस्टमेंट्स दैट कम्स अंडर द प्रिपरेशन ऑफ बैलेंस शीट एज पर द डिटेल्स गिवन इन द क्वेश्चन बेस्ड ऑन रेशियोज। Next case, prepare a balance sheet with as many details as possible from the following financial ratios and information. Working form part of the answer. Assume 360 days in a year. Remember the time for computation of debtors as well as creditors. That is where we are using these days computation. If the question gross profit is given, gross profit ratio is given, stock turnover ratio is given, sales to net worth is given, fixed asset turnover ratio is given, debt collection period is given, credit payment period is given, that is a new adjustment, and reserves and surplus 50,000, long term debt nil. So almost all other items we have dealt in the previous cases, or the only new adjustment is credit payment period. If you are familiar with the debt collection period or debtors computation, credit payment period or creditors computation is simple. So let's deal with this scenario. First one, as usual in the question, gross profit is given and gross profit ratio is given. So we all know what is the concept or what is the meaning of these two information. Since gross profit ratio is gross profit by sales into 100, and we already know gross profit ratio is 0.20 equal to gross profit divided by sales, so you can directly find the amount of sales, that is 4,50,000. Once you have the amount of sales as well as gross profit, next you are going to find is cost of goods sold. So cost of goods sold or cost of sales is sales minus gross profit. And we already computed sales 4,50,000 minus 90,000, you will get 3,60,000 as cost of goods sold. Why we are finding cost of goods sold? That can be used to find the amount of closing stock. See, if you go through all these cases, you will understand why we are using each step. There is a purpose for finding each step. Next one, closing stock. See, after cost of goods sold, we found closing stock. This is the concept of preparation of balance sheet. Almost all the items, there is a purpose. Why we are using that item? Why we are using that ratio? Why we are using this amount? There's a reason for that. If you familiarize those concepts, this question or this case will be very easy for you to deal with. So, closing stock. First, closing stock. We are going to begin with stock turnover ratio. In the question, stock turnover ratio is given 6. And we know that the stock turnover ratio equation is cost of sales divided by closing stock. And stock turnover ratio is 6. So 6 equal to cost of sales. We just found computer 360,000 divided by closing stock. You can easily find the amount of closing stock, ₹60,000. Next we are going to find is net worth. Okay, net worth. In the question, the information regarding net worth is sales to net worth ratio is 1.5. So, what do you know the meaning of sales to net worth? That is sales divided by net worth. So, sales to net worth is sales divided by net worth. So, it is 1.5 equal to 9.5. It is given in the question, equal to sales 4,50,000 divided by net worth. So, finally, net worth is ₹3,00,000. Next one, fixed assets. Fixed asset ratio is cost of sales divided by fixed assets. See, here the information is given, fixed asset turnover ratio is 2. There is no information regarding any fixed assets other than this ratio. So fixed asset ratio is cost of sales divided by fixed assets. Ratio is given in the question 2, cost of sales, we found that cost of sales is 3,60,000, so you can easily find the amount of fixed assets. So fixed asset is 1,80,000. The next you are going to find is debtors. We have dealt the same case numerous times, and we all know how we are going to find the amount of debtors. In the question, debt collection period is 60 days. So debt collection period equation is time divided by debtors turnover ratio. So 60 equal to time, it is in the question, it is specified that you need to take 360. Otherwise also go for 360 because it will be quite easy to find. 360 divided by debtors turnover ratio, because if you go for 365, that is the actual days in a year, you will end up in a decimal number. For computation purpose, try to use 360 days, so you will get a round figure. That is, debtors turnover ratio is 6 times. If you are using 65, it will be 6 point something. That is the reason. So debtors turnover ratio is credit sales divided by debtors. In this question, there is no information regarding credit sales. See, there is no information. The only information is sales. And we have already computed the amount of sales. So we can use that sales as credit sales. So debtors turnover ratio equal to sales 450,000. Here we are already computed. Debtors turnover ratio 6 equal to 450,000 divided by debtors. So the debtors is 75,000. Next one, creditors. It's a new adjustment. It's a new item. We haven't discussed or dealt with from computation of creditors in the previous classes. So the same case, which how you are going to find the amount of debtor, the same situation has to be followed in case of creditors. Here in this case, you need to consider purchases instead of sales. So in the question, it is said that credit payment period is 72 days. So the equation for credit payment period is time divided by creditors turnover ratio. And credit payment period is 72 equal to time, it is 360 divided by creditors turnover ratio. So creditors turnover ratio is 5 times. And next, we know that creditors turnover ratio is credit purchases divided by creditors. Credit purchases divided by creditors. If you go through the question, there is no information regarding purchases. In that case, how you are going to find the amount? Whenever you come across a situation where you have to find the amount of creditors and there is no information regarding credit purchases as well as net purchases, you can assume that cost of goods sold can be used instead of purchase. We already found cost of goods sold here, these 360,000. So just use that amount in case of purchases. And remember, whenever you come across the same type of question, make sure you can find the amount of purchases, because in the question, if there is any information regarding opening stock or direct expenses, you can easily find the amount of purchases, because the cost of goods sold, there is one another equation for finding cost of goods sold, that is opening stock plus purchases plus direct expenses minus closing stock. There is one equation for finding out cost of goods sold. If you have here in this question, cost of goods sold is 360,000. If you were having opening stock as well as direct expenses, in the absence of direct expenses also, you can use opening stock. If opening stock is given, remember it is given to find the amount of purchases. As students, you may use this 360,000 for computation, but remember in the question, if there is information regarding opening stock or direct expenses, remember that is given to find purchases. In this question, there is no information regarding opening stock or direct expenses. You can assume that let that cost of goods sold be purchases. So credit turnover ratio 5 equal 360,000 divided by creditors. So the creditors is 72,000. Next one, share capital. We already found the amount of net worth. We know that net worth is share capital plus reserves and surplus. Net worth is 3 lakhs. We already found share capital. We don't know. Reserves and surplus, if you go through the question, it is given in the question. Reserves and surplus 50,000. So you can easily find the amount of share capital 2,50,000. So we almost found all the items that can be appearing in the balance sheet on the basis of details given. Let's make sure whether the amount is tallying to each other. As per the balance sheet, two sides, T-shaped account. Sorry, it's a statement, not an account. Remember, balance sheet is a statement, not an account. Liabilities, amount, assets, amount. We will begin with fixed assets 180,000 and share capital 250,000. We just found. Next one, reserves and surplus 50,000. So next item in the liability side, reserves and surplus 50,000. Next item, closing stock 60,000. So just note that item in the asset side of the balance sheet, 60,000. Next one, creditors 72,000. Note the amount of creditors in the liability side. Next one, debtors 75,000. So note the same item in the asset side of the balance sheet. So if you go through the totals of the balance sheet, there is a difference of 57,000 in the asset side. See, here the liability side you will get 3,72,000. In the asset side you will not get 3,72,000. There is a difference of 57,000. I already explained how to take, means which amount has to be considered as the actual total of the balance sheet. So here this side is higher, so this will be the total, actual total, and in this side there is a difference of 57,000. So just make sure whether all the items has been recorded in this case: fixed assets, closing stock, debtors, and we already found current assets. So the difference regarding this may be cash. In the previous questions, we already found that there is a difference of certain amount in the case of current assets and other items of current assets. So in this case, while computing balance sheet, we found that the cash is the balancing figure in the case of assets. And make sure while finding the difference, if you find a difference in the balance sheet, you can assume that it may be any of the items that comes under that particular side. If it is assets, there may be items that has to be come under assets. Never ever repeat any items. There can't be two cash in this asset side, as well as there can't be two resource and surplus or two creditors in the liability sides also. And remember, there are items that has to be given prime importance. In the previous sessions, one of the previous sessions, we dealt a case where there is a difference of certain amount in the asset side, and we assume that let that difference be miscellaneous expenditure. That was the case which we have dealt in the previous sessions. And in this case, when we come across a difference, we assumed that let it be cash. Why we dealt like that? That is a case, or that is an issue of doubt that may come across. The reason is, in that question, almost all the items that has to be given prior importance is already found, because in the asset side, fixed asset was there, cash was there, debtors was there, closing stock was there. That's why in that case, we gave miscellaneous expenditure as a name for the difference amount. In this case, cash was not there. So there is the concept is that we have to give prior importance to certain items depending upon the priority. Fixed assets, closing stock, debtors, cash, all these items are of prior importance. So whenever you come across a difference, give prior importance to these items. If these items is already there in the asset side, you can give other names or other examples of current assets. Similarly, that concept has to be followed in case of liability side also. Share capital, reserves and surplus, creditors, and long-term debts. These are the major items that has to be given prior importance. If there is any difference in the liability side, and if you find that any of these four items is missing, you can give important or give the missing name that comes under that priority list. If the priority list or the important items is already there in the liability side, and if you get a difference in the liability side, you can give any of the example that comes under the liability side of the balance sheet. That is the concept of giving name, or finding how to give or how to find the difference amount and how to name that difference amount. So I hope you almost understand what is the concept of preparation of financial statement or preparation of balance sheet on the basis of ratios given in the question. So just go through all these cases which we have dealt in the previous sessions. You may find all some of the questions may be similar, but there are some adjustments that are quite peculiar for each case. Some adjustments are new, some are quite confusing, and some are quite hidden. So familiarize each situation. If you go thoroughly, you can understand that almost all cases are following a similar pattern. Only difference is the change in numbers. So today we will wind up this module, and next session onwards we will begin with a new module. So that's all. Thank you.